good message Sunday, Pastor.
Amen.
Very good message Sunday.
Oh, you think so?
Yes.
All of them have been.
What was that about? he was one snowing.
Yeah, it's very good, very good.
Sometimes you never know how people receive the word.
I went home and organized it better, so I can
follow that.
Yeah, that's good stuff. Good stuff.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you today for your loving kindness and tender mercies. Thank you that we have all things that pertain to life and unto justice. Thank you that you are for us. And if you be for us, who can be against us? Thank you for the atoning work of Jesus, our Lord, our Savior. Live this life that we might have life. Thank you, Father. Just for the unjust, bring us to God. We are before you today, we're alive unto you, open to your word, open to your spirit. Thank you, Father, we deal with you and fellowship with you through the power of your Holy Ghost. In Jesus' name we give you all the praise and glory.
Amen.
Glory, God. I can dig through a wall. I find out who I am in Christ. That's the main thing that kept me saved was once I found out who I was in Christ. You always hear the, boy, you better be good. God knows what you're doing. And it was like, you know what the Lord has done?
That's right.
And what he's
That's it.
Given you.
Yes.
It's worthwhile living.
Yes.
It's worthwhile giving up all that other stuff. The world has to attract and offer you. I went over to UPS, delivered some boxes. I made an order for something for my corporate office. It was supposed to be delivered to me by Tuesday. Monday, Tuesday, the lady still hadn't got it. Lady knocked on the door today. You don't know what you tell you. Well, your stuff been delivered over to my house 2 blocks over, back there. And I said, okay, 800 block back over there on another street. So I go over there. And it's an old friend of mine. Back in the school days, same age, he might be 1 or 2 years old. Maybe the only difference between us. Mm-hmm. On the walk. And it's, you know, I'm just, oh, this is 20 years. Walk. So he couldn't help me get the boxes and load them up myself. Pretty good sized boxes. I bet each and every one of them about 40 pounds. Paperwork and stuff like that. It was heavy. Look at me.
He's so humble.
Modest, good looking. But I can't remember when I go to, you know why they're about a fellow home? Shopping center over there, got a liquor store, convenience store, and I can, he used to have a little Corvette that you drove around, the sharp big Corvette. You see him with a half a pint in his pocket all the time, lit up. So, see, if I was staying in that same course,
you see.
That's so, living for the Lord and not living for the Lord.
Man.
I can see where I would be. I knew what the glass house was. Some of y'all still don't know what the glass house is. You know where it's located? It's a glass house. I could go in there when
what
I was 13, 14 years old.
It's like a store. Cincinnati.
That one on the corner?
Yeah.
Pine in Cincinnati?
It's called
Apache in Cincinnati.
Name the glass house. But he's around the corner. He goes into that liquor store. Used to it. I hadn't seen him. And now I see why I hadn't seen him. So, you know, my boast is in the Lord. I was on the same track. Somebody didn't get to, is what I said. Somebody didn't get to the word. least we get it. Some folks don't get any reality. As I finished up yesterday's, I mean Sunday's message, I was in Job 37, I think, which is Job 38. And we know the story, how Job got that worthless advice from his friends. Let's look at Job, first chapter, and see how we get a description of his name. And two, kind of give us maybe the first three or four verses and tell us what kind of guy this was.
There was
chapter 1, the first three or four verses there.
There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job, and that man was perfect and upright, and one that feared God and eschewed evil. And there were born unto him 7 sons and 3 daughters. His substance also was 7,000 sheep and 3,000 camels and 500 yoke of oxen and 500 she asses and a very great household, so that this man was the greatest of all the men of the east.
My Lord, that's good enough right there. Come on, with his substance, 7,000 sheep, all this, had a very great household. He had it going on. He was a witness for the Lord, bringing glory to God, not working with him because he was a righteous man. We understand that he fell into evil through fear. The thing that he feared the most came upon him, worried about losing it all. Worried about, it can't be this good all the time. This can't be like this all the time. Something is going to trip me up. I'm going to, something's out there. How many hear about the West now? How many worry about the mosquito? I already got calls. Did you know about them? Yeah, I've been there twice. Since Sunday. I ain't gonna worry about it, you know. But there's something, fear. Fear is the opposite of what? Faith. That's a driving force. It's real. It can drive you into bad decisions and the whole nine. Because just like faith can drive you into the right decisions, fear can take you the other way. Yeah. Just thank you. Yeah. What could go wrong? Yeah. What could go wrong? That's how Job got caught up. So now that he's in his mess, well, since I already managed in your mess, as I'm a good friend of yours, full of carnality, let me sit down and tell you what you could have done wrong. What you are, what's going on with you? Yeah, something wrong. I mean, it's obvious. You had everything, now you got nothing. Sick as can be, broke as can be. What happened to your life? Upside down. Let's sit down, let's talk this out. And from a sensual point of view, mental ascent, here's where it is. Talk to your wife. She'll tell you. Not Job, because God not. Give it up. Can't recover from this. It is really messed up. Curse God not. Get it over with. Bad piece of advice coming from the world system. So Job knew he lived with God and was right with God. So and his friends told him the same stuff. Okay. So look at Job 38, verse 1 through 7. God got mad. All right, let's see if you want to jump to it. Thank you. So Job's going to go up there and argue with God. Anybody ever done that? Right? It ain't going right, God. You see it, I see it, everybody else see it.
It ain't right.
Stuff ain't going on. It should be happening to me. I don't deserve all. Why me? Anybody? Why me? So the Lord answered Job and said, who is this that darkened counsel by words without what? You don't know what you're talking about, Job. I come out first. You don't know what you're talking about. Gird up now thy loins like a man, for I will demand of thee, and answer thou me. What was thou when I laid the foundations of the earth? Who hath laid them? Verse 5, who laid the measures thereof? And thy knowest, who stretched the line upon it? Whereupon are the foundations thereof fastened? And who laid the cornerstone thereof? Who's holding all this together? When the morning stars sang together and all the sons of God shouted for joy, who shut up the sea with the doors when it break forth as it has issued out of the womb? When I made the cloud the garment thereof and the thick darkness a waddling band for me. So God wants to know, Job, what was you when I thought of all this stuff? And since you don't have the nerve to tell me how things go. Hadn't dawned upon Job that it's something that I've done, although he can't pinpoint it, it's something that I did to cause this calamity in my life. What's going on? And the number one thing that messes people up is, I tell you all this for a quarter each, thank him. As a man, it's not a light statement, but it's reality. So man, think. How are you thinking? Now the Lord is going to have to work with us on our thinking, because our thinking gets us in trouble. Our thinking drives us to some actions, and our actions get the result that you've been thinking about. No way you're going to get a result that you wasn't thinking about. You're going to get what you've been thinking about. So, Job come to a realization, Job 42, God's asked me all of these questions. Oh, I got no answers. Oh, he told me I better answer up. Answer me like a man, like you know what to do. So, man up. Job 42, verse 1. Someone got that? Take it through verse 6. Long time here.
Then Job answered the Lord and said, I know that thou canst do everything, and that no thought can be withholden from thee. Who is he that hideth counsel without knowledge? Therefore have I uttered that I understood not, things too wonderful for me which I knew not. Here I beseech thee, and I will speak. I will demand of thee and declare thou unto me. I have heard of thee by the hearing of the ear, but now my eye seeth thee.
Yes.
Wherefore I abhor myself and repent in dust and ashes.
That's right. So that's what Job says. I've been wrong. I've been proud. I had it all. It was all my doing.
That's right.
All of that I had, it was all because of me. I was the glue that held it together. And I heard about you. But now that I've been in front of you and you laid it out to me, now I have revelation knowledge. As God told him, who is this coming up here with no knowledge?
Yes.
That's the first big mistake we get when we get in trouble and we go to people, they have no revelation knowledge. Two systems in the world today. It's the Babylonian system and it's God's system. You got to choose which one you're going to operate. The Babylonian system is a system of buying and selling. That's how you get ahead, buying and selling. That's why buying and selling human beings were no big deal. Never. Buying and selling slaves and all like that was no, that's the way to get ahead. It's one of the components of getting ahead. Some folks still in that. 100% into that. Buying and selling. Get up every day figuring out how they're going to make it from each other. And then God has a system ever since the world began, since the foundation of the world, as long as the earth stands, is what?
Seed time and harvest.
You got to prepare and determine which one you're going to operate, which one is going to bring you what you want.
That's right.
Oh. And Babylonian one is so apparent, it's so obvious, and, I mean, it's so real that people get up and too old to go to work. Hey, I'm 75 years old, should be retired, but I'm going to Walmart to apply for a degree. Push the card fast. Because I don't have enough resources, or what happened. Some of them are cutting grass on top of roofs, I'm doing all kinds of stuff just to, what they call it, get the ends to meet, make some money, make some substance, because I'm staying, and that's all I know from childhood on up. Just doing it every day, every day, every day. How many of them have cursed at, talked about preachers or what have you, anybody that comes around with a charitable cause? I find some kind of fall in. But God's system is a system of sowing and reaping. And it has nothing to do with Babylonian, the way stuff goes on over there. Most folks is over there, and they won't get into over here. They're over there and bad mouth what's going on over here. That was Job in his crowd. Phew. That's hard to do. My name is Hold On. But that's what happens. So we have to determine, as believers, first of all, how we're going to manage our thinking. That's the big part, is to manage our thinking. So let's jump over to Romans 12. And, you know, I talked about the Kingdom Sunday. We used to have stuff our way since day one. We're told that you are independent, you're a free person. You can say and do what you want to do, when you want to do it, however you want to do it, you can do that. That's not true when you're in God's kingdom. You have to speak as a representative, an ambassador. You can't be somebody going off here doing your thing, saying your thing. And Jesus came here as that perfect, we'll see it in a minute, as that perfect ambassador. He was talked about, trying to entrap him, and all kinds of things you can do to a man to make him get angry. He would say, I'm only speaking what I'm supposed to be talking about. The words I say to you ain't mine.
That's right.
Sometimes you might say that. Mm-hmm. Child, what I got to say to you is because the Lord is telling me. But if I was to tell you what I really want to tell you, we wouldn't be friends anymore. So I'm going to tell you, God loves you. Ain't in love with you. I want to say, you stupid. You dummy. What's your common sense? But you have to come out in love and say, this is what the Lord says. This is what the Word says. And are you going to go with it? So here's Romans 12:2. I've done stupid stuff. Okay, 2 Corinthians 5:20 talks about that ambassadorship. But here's what he says in Romans 12:1. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. That's what ambassadorship is, a service. Be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your, we know it, mind. Be ye transformed, be changed, be different, so that you can prove what is good, acceptable, perfect will of God. So that you can prove by being transformed. Now he says, through the grace of God given to me, to every man that is among you, to do what?
To think of yourself more highly than
the object. That was Job's part. I got all of this, I'm the best in the land, got the best of everything. Look at me. Do you think a degree of pride did not get into Job? What if he had the biggest spread of all Tulsa system? I mean, he had something to like the hills.
You have pray to stay humble. I mean, I think most of
them,
they're honest.
Nice green manicured lawn. You've seen the workers come cutting it down and keeping it nice for you. You had a personal assistant. You know what? You guys have any idea what wealth is like? You seen wealth, haven't you, Sister Marion? You know the real rich people have what they call a personal assistant. You know that? From the time they get up in the morning time, they got somebody right there by their side. Shoes. Great, wipe me down. Person says, I want some coffee. Okay. And you think that won't make you get pride? You have to watch out for pride. Open the door for you, close the door for you, do everything for you. It's called personal assistant. Romney's got one. All rich folks. Don't go nowhere after personal assistant. And if you get pretty comfortable, pretty nice. Says not to think of yourself highly than you ought to be thinking. And Job had, he said, a household, so he had people doing everything for him. Household. So that's the key. Don't think too high of yourself, but to think soberly, according as God has dealt to every man the measure of what? Faith. Now, faith on the side of coming up, growing into, developing into, is a different kind of faith than once you have obtained. See, a millionaire, he don't get up using his faith to make more money. You know, now we get up every day and have faith to pay the bills. Rich man don't use faith for that.
It's already done. Yeah.
It's already done. There's some kids that don't know nothing about not enough. Mom, can we go to a music park this week and over here tomorrow and over there? People that gets up and pray for faith to make it through the week or so forth, they don't think about it. You know what? Well, they do think about it. You know, we got to see if we got enough resources for that. But a rich kid asks his mom and dad those kind of things. He said, yo, if we got time.
Uh-huh. That's right.
That's the only challenge. It's enough time to get it done. When we go visit, say, well, we got enough time. It's never about, do we have enough money? Money? What do you mean we have enough money? That's never thought. What about money?
And then, Brother Donnell, they buy the whole amusement park so that can't nobody be there but them.
Sure. I do that. Sure. So, they the thinking is what? A little bit different. And we're thinking on terms of enough. They're thinking on terms of we got it. So they don't use their faith for that kind of stuff.
They don't need to.
So God has dealt to everybody a degree of faith. And faith takes you from glory to glory. Step up, step up, step up. So it depends on, you know, what you should think it. Oh, boy. Okay, so watch your thinking. Now, he's going to tell us how to think here in a minute. He's going to tell us over there in Philippians when he introduced Jesus and his thinking. Here was Jesus. We've been there many times. We've gone over there in Philippians. I think it's Philippians 2. Maybe Philippians 3. I think it's Philippians 2. Philippians 2 and 2. Fill ye my joy, that ye be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord. How many minds?
A mind.
One mind. Now that one mind is coming from the king in a kingdom structure, a democracy. One mind is impossible. In a democracy, how many opinions? Well, let's take a vote. That's what they do in the democracy. Let's vote. The majority win. If the majority wins and say marriage is now same sex, majority win. If the majority say this and that, no matter whether it's moral or immoral, the majority rules. In a kingdom, he don't care about what you think. That's what he told Joe. Joe, I don't care about who would stand up here. What would you do? How do you keep the earth from flying all over the place? Tell me how I do that. Tell me how I keep the ocean from just all over. Well, tell me how, since you know so much, Job, tell me, where was you, Job, when I did? And who did all this? One person. Right. Guess who you answer to, and guess what you're going to be talking? What the king says. So, to represent God on the earth, you have to talk like he talked to experience the benefits of his kingdom. And that's the hardest thing for people to do, is to talk like he talks, or to say what he says. Because you can be challenged. Now, what do you think about, let's see, if I was supporting the Democratic candidate, so what do you think about abortion, Williams? I hate it. Where the platform, Democratic platform, says it's legal. I hate it. I don't know. So I'm not speaking in line with what? My party. But for God, Democratic, there's no Democrats. Kingdom. Williams, what do you think about taking your neighbor's wife? It's against the law of God. Period. No questions asked. And you get this slick guy next door and says, I'm up and down three or four wives up and down. And the influences. So somebody got to stay with what he says. Say it like he said. All the way from all the benefits of redemption, atoning work, you got to speak like he talks in order to enjoy the benefits of the kingdom. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Let's go get some Krispy Kreme. Okay. All right. Somebody, you look at 2 Corinthians 5 and 20. Can someone give me your take on that? 2 Corinthians 5 and 20.
Okay.
All right. Let me ask you then. Keep that right there, Sister Dorothy. when God gives you revelation versus you're working, trying to get it out or figure it out, what is easier, the revelation that God gives to you to figure that thing out, or your toil and labor? Which one is this?
The revelation.
Revelation. How do you think Adam did his stuff? By toiling?
Or by revelation?
Woo! Let's dance. By revelation. What is that over there? Adam, that's a common building. Call it an elephant. It's an elephant. Oh, it's an elephant. Ooh. Adam looked this up and trying to figure it out. Who gave you understanding?
God.
Revelation. No work. So when you get God reveals stuff to you, isn't it so easy?
Yes.
He said, man, I was such a dummy. I was rocking my head over this wall trying to figure that out. And God, the Holy Ghost just dropped that in my spirit. Everything was crystal clear. That's right. Because Adam was laying up with Eve. Well, I never said that. I should say that for a Sunday. Right. Revelation. Revelation. Adam get hungry. Adam, you want some potatoes? You got to go plant some potatoes. Is that the way it was?
No.
Adam wants potatoes. Let's go up to the potato what? Crop.
Right.
Yeah. You want some of this, some of that? What do you? It was all provided before Adam even got there.
That's true.
Adam's some of Jesus. Ooh, it's so good. Man. Nice. Everything that Adam was doing with the Eden blessing was by revelation. What Adam accomplished was through revelation from God, and he's just doing good. What makes life hard? The way of a transgressor.
It's hard. Or no revelation.
No revelation. I should have went to the scripture. Y'all, this is in Romans, but deep things of God revealed to us by His Spirit. Is that Romans? First Corinthians. God has revealed them to us by His Spirit. First Corinthians,
yeah, 2 and 10.
Yeah. 1 Corinthians 2:10. And that's why for verse 9 is that we don't know what God is, the things which God had prepared for them that love Him. See, God had it prepared for Adam. But God has revealed them unto us how? By His Spirit. So we get revelation. The Spirit search all things, yea, the deep things of God. So He wants to deal with us and fellowship us with us by revealing it to us. The things you know about God that's really embedded in your heart, I can't pull them out for nothing in the world. It's because it's revealed. It's just ain't just said to you. It's revealed. I can tell you all they are. I mean, you're not saved. I don't care what you say. You're not saved. No. I got revelation on that. I got real deal on that. I can't pull it out. And this is what God is trying to get to us, is revelation knowledge. And that's why He got so mad at Job. Job, you don't know nothing. You got nerve to get mad and talk all that. You don't know nothing. No knowledge. And then so Adam going around the garden doing pretty good. Revelation knowledge here and there. Revelation knowledge here and there. And then, life gets hard because sin got in the way. You can't receive from God. Now, Adam, if you get hungry after you've been messed up, guess how you're going to have to eat from now on?
Work.
That's right. Sweat out of your brow.
It ain't changed since that day. Except for revelation knowledge. If God gives you revelation knowledge, Was, how is that evident? Is evident in things like, even though the man had invented the electricity or the light bulb or the light, it wasn't just like, bam, that he got that knowledge. He had to go through so many experiments and so much exhausting stuff to at least, they said, well, how did you finally get this? I finally came across something that worked. Mm-hmm. Oh, you didn't? No, I just came across something that worked. Kept trying, 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 and that thing worked. I remember what I did, so now we got it. That's how. Still today, when men, most men invent something or create something, it's a long line of failure before they get to success.
Ooh. But that man that operates in that revelation knowledge to a high degree, The world calls him a genius.
Yeah.
And because things come so naturally to him that they can't comprehend how he gets it, so they label it genius. Whereas it's really, really, really
revelation knowledge. How many used to have a transistor radio put in your pocket? At the time, that was genius. Now that we look back, it's electricity. It's all like neutrons. Electrons, neutrons, it's electricity once we look back on it. You wasn't that brilliant, but at the time, it
was brilliant. It's still pretty brilliant.
It's still pretty. I mean, you know, how much time I'm about to put up in there.
Take from Mars, you're able to send pictures back.
Yeah, yeah. Right now, today, it's awesome.
300 million miles.
Awesome.
So that's pretty serious.
That's awesome. Awesome.
Yeah.
I talked about some few years when we were kids, Dick Tracy with the watch and the telephone in the pocket and all that stuff. That was so, oh man, it was so dreamy. It was so good. Now today, we don't have that stuff. So here we go. How is this? How is man to walk in the kingdom of God? Through revelation knowledge. And most folks won't try and get it through sense that don't make sense.
That's it.
What you're talking don't make sense. And they'll throw you off your faith
That's
wall.
Right.
And all your fellowship with God, because they're going to come like Job's friends did. Job, you know, something had to go wrong, man. They're going to confess up. Something was going up with you. Come on, let's hear. Why, Joe, gonna curse God and die and quit? You know, you think something's up? Joe said, and then he tried to face God with his pride. Okay, so there's always for a man to walk in God's kingdom, he has to do it by revelation knowledge. And the reconciliation is to bring earth and heaven, bam, together for us to experience earth and heaven reality. Some folks are going to wait until they die and go to heaven and see what's going on. You're going to be so surprised that God's going to say, the way you walking around here all day, you could have been doing that down on the earth and enjoying things just as well. Whoa! Yeah. You didn't have to wait till you got to heaven to be well, to be rich, to have peace. You didn't have to wait till you get to heaven to do that. A lot of preachers preach, wait till we get to the other side of Jordan. They ain't a better place now. So the Bible says, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. So he's talking, the reconciliation is now. But it's done by faith and revelation knowledge and living right, righteous for the Lord. A righteous man living for God. He's bringing heaven and earth together. That's the reconciliation. Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, it tells us that the kingdom of heaven is within us.
Mm-hmm.
Inside of us. So it's not where it comes down from outside of us. Kingdom of heaven is within us.
It's within us. And here's the question. To live where? On the what?
On the earth.
The earth.
I mean, we're here on the earth, And if the kingdom of heaven is in us, which is a spiritual thing, mm-hmm. it's totally spiritual. Mm-hmm. It's not a physical attribute in us right now, but it's more physical, it's more spiritual.
It's more inner.
Right, it's inner journey.
It's inner in us, get what we want the earth to do for us.
Produce for us.
But if it's inner, it's going to be shown
out.
Because it has to be.
Right.
That's correct.
Because Adam got the earth to do what he wanted it to do. It's yours, Adam. Manage it. Dominion. Dominate it. Do what you want to do. It's all yours, Adam. And Adam's just the man.
That's right.
But he promised us that too. And he said we could do the same works, so even greater. That means the present day.
When Jesus walked this earth, he was trying to show heaven and earth reconciled. It was amazing. They had never seen nothing like this before. Who is this guy?
Right.
And everybody followed him. All the crowds just followed him. Why are you following him? Because we try to get what he got. We still got messed up minds and heads. And we sure like to have whatever he's got. The lady at the well says, give me what you got. Give it to me.
But isn't that the importance of the changing of our thinking?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because if anything comes to it, it first has to enter our thought process.
Hello.
Our consciousness.
Hello.
That's the only way we can acknowledge it is through our consciousness. Mm-hmm. So if we have a consciousness of something, then we may be able to operate it.
That's right. But if we think about it,
the
thoughts are going to lead you to some type of action. And that action is going to make you some type of result. Well, we can be dissuaded. Oh, no.
Don't work like that.
No. Stop walking and saying you're walking in hell. Who do you think you are? Peter, walking on the water, doing great. Doing great. A wind roared up. You like, hey, it's supposed to be walking on the water. Said I can't walk in here. They saying all that when I'm looking at it. You didn't observe my advantages for sake of life.
Yeah.
Of course. Buy into their opinion for sake of your own good. That's just the way it is. That's why you're dying on earth. Ooh, man. Okay. So, reconciling. And what was that we saw there? Let's go back to Ephesians and look there. The second chapter again. So this is verse 5. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus.
Yes.
Who being in the form of God, thought it not what? Robbery to be equal with God. Because and it's just like Hillary Clinton, when she's the Secretary of State, she has all the power at her disposal when she's out doing her work, as President Obama do if he was there. And he sends her to Egypt, Saudi Arabia, or whatever it is. When she takes off out of New York and fly across the globe, she has all the full power, resources, and everything else that her boss has. And that's the same thing with us, is that when Jesus was walking here on the earth, he saw himself just like God. I speak like he speak. What he say, I would say.
That's right.
Everything you hear coming from me, what you will hear coming from him.
That's right.
And don't care what the situation was, whatever it is, whatever he would say, I'm saying. And we'll look at the so-and-so. Whatever he would say, I would say. He says, well, we got some situations here. Here's the woman taken in adultery. Now let's see you put some judgment on her. same story. Talked themselves right out of us. He shut up. He just said he would cast the first. What was that without even saying, throw the first stone? He just shut up and left it there. You can't do that. He says, well, what was your accusers? None. He says, I don't condemn you either. Go and sin no more. That's what he would say. Go and sin no more. And he said that changed the whole situation. So when Jesus was telling that woman at the well that if you had what I had, if you operated like I operate, you would have stuff springing up out of you like a well of living. You would see so much good stuff happening in your life. Oh. And she says, give me that. What you talking about? So what we want people to do is to say to us, show me what you get. Show me how I can get what you have. Because my life is, and we know people's lives is what turned upside down. Kids are shooting so-and-so. Football stars jumping on their mother. You hear about that, Brother Holman? Slapping their mother? You hear about that? There's Brian.
It's been a while.
Out of OSU. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
People know that kind of crazy kind of stuff. Little girl is not saved. You hear about Greenwood just last night?
Mm-hmm.
Just yesterday? You know about the track around in my car, but you might know about that.
Yeah,
11-year-old waiting for her mom to finish up on one of the bridges out there. 3 men in the truck come by and pick up the little girl. Throwing some issues and try and rape her, think they did rape her. She come out screaming and hollering, and the mom comes running. What's going on? So the truck runs up. This is why I don't care. People got goofed up minds. That was, and, you know, mankind is goofed up. He doesn't know the nature or the will of God whatsoever. Man, it's so messed up. So this is why I say, William say, that North Tulsa needs to see a light that they would say, what did you, how did you, how did you, how is that happening to you? All that good stuff happening to you in the midst of economic recession, gas almost $3.60 a gallon, all this. Now, how are you doing what you do? How is this possible? Instead of us hunkering down, Lord bless us. If we stay well, if you know, and talking to the devil instead of talking the word, the confession of the word. As soon as a person stops confessing, I call it the Constitution, saying what the King says, you so far out of bounds, I don't know if you can get back. Sometimes when we say stuff, I don't know if you can get back. So far off the script. I'm so broke, I'm so sick, I'm so ain't got enough, I ain't got enough, this and that. And this. Bible says all things are yours. That's what the script says. That's what you're supposed to be saying as ambassador. Just say that.
Yes.
Just say that. You remember that lady that child got sick in the Old Testament? And she was carrying him, and she passed by the prophet. And he says, what's wrong? Can I do something? Can I pray for you? She said, it's all well. Mm-hmm. You remember that story? It's all well. The prophet wanted to stop her and get her to confess. What's wrong? What's wrong with you? He said, it's all well. I've got to get in here to this prophet over here so he can lay hands. I think it was Elijah. Got to get over here. It's all well. Maybe it was dead. It's all well. Soon as she'd have said that he's dead and can't, it'd have been over. She said, it's all way. Abraham, learning how to talk. Hold stuff right here, my servant. The lad and I will be back.
Yes.
I'm going up here to kill him, but the lad and I will be back. Now that's talking in the crunch. The pressure's on. Hold the donkeys and stuff down here. The lad and I will be back.
That's right.
Come on, lad.
That's right.
And so how do you figure that? He says that If God was able to give them to me at 99 or 100 years old, He's able to give them to me again. Some God, He's able to do it. You know, I just know that if He did it that time, He's telling me to do this. I don't have all the kind of answers you asking for. What's wrong, all these? And we'll be back. Just hold up right here. When the crunch is on, most of the time when the crunch is on, oh, we're sick, we're dead, we're broke, we're poor, we can't, we ain't. We're so far off script and I can't move. He was in a city called Nazareth, Jesus was, and he could do no mighty works there because was something wrong with Jesus that day?
No.
What film did he feel like? What was nothing wrong with Jesus? It's just an atmosphere. Everybody talking and so much unbelief, it ain't going to happen here.
That's a very interesting point. I mean, here in his hometown, mm-hmm. in that it's a community, mm-hmm. and it was a community mindset mm-hmm. of unbelief.
Yeah, yeah.
And here, Christ was not able to do a miracle.
In his own hometown. Because of unbelief.
But that's almost relevant today
yeah.
as far as
yeah.
almost African people.
Yeah,
that's relevant.
As far as what people say,
yeah.
they're not worth anything.
Yeah, that's all you got to do. What is it?
But it's a community. Thing? Yeah, but I'm saying it's a community
yeah.
mindset.
Condition. Yeah, condition.
Yeah, they have a mindset. It's a mindset that, when you said that, it's a mindset that mm-hmm. can even be set up.
Mm-hmm.
In a community.
Yeah, yeah. What is poverty?
Mindset.
That's all. Mm-hmm. That's all.
That's all. That's all.
Neighbor think like that. Go across the street.
But
other neighbor think same way.
But if you get to the community base,
uh-huh.
and that community has that mindset,
mm-hmm.
then it.
Well, what did Jesus
I guess
say
it requires more prayer.
Yeah.
Consecration to be able to break that because he wasn't able to do it.
No, that's right. What did he do? Instead of Nazareth being his headquarters,
sure.
he left and went to Galilee.
That's right.
Setting up shop.
He got up out.
Out of here. That's what he did. Can't work here. So he went to Galilee and set up shop in Galilee.
But I'm looking at today's context, we can put that into our
sure. Now, you know,
families.
Sure.
So you can just go with your being saved and trying to bless your brother, your sister,
yeah, yeah.
they just can't hear you.
Right.
And I mean, exactly. you have to have
family,
you have
everybody.
To say, okay, Lord, send another labor across their bed because
yeah.
they're not going to hear
yeah,
from me.
I can't deal with this. I'm out of here. I laid all of my pearls on them. I'm swine like everything else over for me. I done did everything. Prayed for them, visited them, gave them money, did this and that and all that, and they still ain't gonna move. I mean, grow. Jesus, I can't do nobody work here.
Reason he couldn't do any mighty work
mm-hmm.
is that they were closed minded.
Yeah.
They didn't know about Jesus
right.
till he got there.
Yeah. yeah.
So, but they didn't even want to hear. They didn't even want to. They just closed their mind.
Well, he's a carpenter's son.
That's right.
They
we know
from
you.
They knew him before.
Yeah.
His
we know your dad.
Yeah.
Who do you think you are? Ain't nobody
yeah.
trying to hear
yeah.
you.
Come
the
on,
minds were
come on.
Come on. Yeah, come on.
But
we know
thinking,
Joseph.
Yeah.
I'm throwing
his money.
Stop your
anointing.
Stop
your
anointing. Right in his track.
Yeah.
He's doing all he can. And he's doing what what a normal human being would do. Look what my anointing, look what I got.
That's it.
What are you going to go
right.
short off? At
right.
home.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Hey, everybody, look at me. You know, hey, you know, look what the Lord has done for me. Hey, Lord said, look at that hammer.
That's right.
Yeah. You know, get back over there and do your thing. You know, you're a carpenter. You know, what you gonna know what you doing?
Right.
I said the same thing about me when I got saved. You'll be back. You just high on something when you come down, you'll be back. You know, and believe me, they came to my house every day at 5 o'clock after work with the stuff. Trying to set up. He said, oh man. I told you I got saved. Oh man, come on this. Okay, we'll give you a week. You come down, whatever that is you're on, you'll be back. They tried me. They sure did. You'll be back. Any man being Christ is a new creature, all things pass away. And God is trying to reconcile, trying to get his kingdom in you on the earth. Woo. Lord. That's what kept me saved. Kate was pregnant with God. I feel like a weight was. Didn't know much, didn't know nothing. Just knew that, man, it's different. But when I walked out, it was different. Wow. Then when I read the Bible, Genesis, got through that. Matthew, I just jumped over to Matthew. Got through that. Then the Lord started blessing a little understanding, revelation knowledge. Sitting in the Baptist Brotherhood. They said it was okay for Abraham to have Hagar for his wife. Oh, yeah, we was showing like some crazy stuff. Went long, left foot fellowship.
Left foot.
Out of here, William. You
ain't sick.
Yeah, we love you, but, you know. Well, but the words at the bottom, they didn't say that.
So they went
to
Revelation
Knowledge. Going to Revelation Knowledge. That was, to me, it was Revelation Knowledge. That, oh, God didn't want Abraham to be messing with Hagar.
No. It wasn't faith.
God said, no, but they had, everybody had wives. Extra wives. That was the day said, everybody, move on. Yeah, that might be true, but it just ain't the way that I'm getting it.
Just
you
know? His will for Abraham.
I was a young dude working in the Lord. That's the way I'm getting it from the Lord. So, you let preachers, teachers, and everybody else talk you out of what God is blessing you with, revelation, knowledge, what have you. Run out of your faith walk because it don't make sense. It says this. This is common sense. Good sense. Boy, you got good sense. Hurry. But made himself with no reputation. Philippians 2 and 7. Took upon him the form of a servant. Made in the likeness of man. Anybody got the time?
10 after.
Been found in fashion as a man. He humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. God highly exalted him and given him a name. So we see what his reward was, but he didn't think it was odd to speak like God did, to act like God. It wasn't no big deal. That's the way that he was going to operate his life. I'm going to get to a scripture here. Let's see here. St. John 14, verses, chapter 9. St. John 14, chapter, verse 9. One of the disciples had a hard time. I think it was Philip. Have I been so long with you, and yet thou hast not known me? Philip, he that hath seen me hath what?
Seen the Father.
Seen the Father. And how say thou then, show us the Father? Because Jesus says, I've been doing just what he would do. Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not what?
Myself.
Not mine. But the Father that dwelleth in me, he do the works. So he says, you know, what I speak is not me, it's not mine. Then St. John 20, verse 21, St. John 20, chapter verse 21. Then said Jesus to them again, peace be unto you, as my Father has done what?
Sent
me, so what?
So
I send you. I'm sending you. Mm-hmm. It's an identical process in the kingdom. And it's different. It's almost impossible to hear everybody speaking the same thing. His New Testament says that all speak the same thing. But the Episcopalians, they say something. The Catholics say something else. The Baptists say something else. Catholics got something to say. Zebedee and Ben has got something to say. Everybody say that they're speaking for the same Lord, but they all got something different to say. How is this? Off script. Somebody off script. So we just say, the Constitution says, that's all I know. The Constitution says, boom. That's all you can say. Just speak that. Leave it alone. That's what the word says. The word says. The word says. Praise God. So, we talked about actions and what Job had to do. Job had to repent. And sometimes we think of repent as walking away from sin. And it is that, walking away from sin. But it's pretty much walking away from the direction you're going in. Make 180, go the other way. That's what repentance, change your mind. Mm-hmm. Have a mind change. And that's what holds people back in anything that's contrary to God's will. When a whole person back is not God delivering, but the mindset that the captive is in. He doesn't want to come out, he won't do what he has to do to come out of that predicament. Who was it in the belly of the whale?
Jonah.
Okay, Jonah. You see, you know what got you in there? Mm-hmm. Keep talking like that. I ain't going there. May God kill him. He's in the belly of the whale. Alright? You know how you got in this mess. What you gonna do? Jonah said, I gotta get out of here.
Yes.
Change his thinking. He repented. When he repented, circumstances had to call for him. He was no more mentally conditioned for that. So poverty, man, poverty had to give me up.
Yes.
I got the millionaire mindset. Can't live in the ghetto, sister. Stinks. I gotta move. I gotta go. Can't drive a rattle trap car. That just ain't me no more. That was like that when I was broke in my pocketbook, but my mindset was certainly different.
Mm-hmm. My club girl was the girl I used to tell her. Well, of course, I live in North Tulsa. I still live in North Tulsa.
That don't mean you're in the ghetto. The ghetto.
I used to tell her, I said, baby, we reside in North Tulsa. We don't live in the ghetto in my house.
That's right.
And she started telling that to other
Hello,
cousins or whatever.
You hear people say ghetto? Maybe people do something. People say that's ghetto. Or something. Throw paper out on the ground or something like that. Throw your McDonald's bag out the car.
Ghetto.
You know, some folks will do that and what? Don't pay no attention to it. Slap it out there, empty the ashtray all over the place. Because
ghetto
mindset, you know. And as soon as my mind got into the Word, and the seed of the Word found, I just couldn't.
Yeah.
You know, I said, no, I can't get that one at all. I'm gonna stop buying hamburger helper. Buy that so much.
Man, I see
it. Buy that so much. Hamburger helper. How about anybody ever heard of water bread? It's a kind of cornbread.
How about
cornbread?
I bet that's delicious.
Oh. And I mean,
we had 11 kids, you know, and that was a stable. Hot water cornbread.
It wasn't a stable for them to treat.
You bite that?
Cold.
Drink it. Then you get cold, you know, it was even pretty good deal.
That's
you know?
Right.
Especially when you was hungry, you know. Pretty good deal. My mother, every day in school day, every day, just about the morning breakfast was oatmeal.
Yeah.
I got some tired oatmeal. It has taken me years and years as an adult. As good as it is for me. Oatmeal. That's some title. Oatmeal.
Cornflakes will
water. Well, yeah, water.
Hey, put water in and stretch it.
No, I
come from a family of mine too. So I know exactly.
Late from a sporting event, like this time of day, football practice, basketball practice, get in by 8:39, Everybody already ate. Yeah. There's chicken for dinner. Guess what parts is left?
The neck.
The neck in the back.
My brother's roommate said that. He said it was almost a fight for the chicken.
So, you know, and some, you can either get conditioned for that, raise your family like that, or you can just say, and as soon as you're thinking is had enough of it, then it drives you to action.
That's right.
To get you some results. And you never would have got those results if you hadn't changed your thinking. Whoa. Some people, in the ghettos, just get comfortable.
That's right. That's true. That's true. The mindset.
Some people comfortable, get comfortable being sick, baby. That's the way it is, you know. Run to the family.
Well, but that's the way of the world, though. I mean, the world is comfortable with being the way they are versus
trying to find the things of God,
working with the things of God.
Yeah.
Change takes effort.
Yeah, it does.
Just feel don't like, I don't want to take that.
That's right.
Yeah, I won't take that action.
Because everybody won't be saved. It's God's will that everybody be saved.
Everybody
is not going to accept it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, for us to be that light on the shining hill, you know, that's our mandate, and to bring people to Christ, but only if they're willing.
Only if they're willing.
And if God draws
them. And God draws them, and He's using you. They see. You want them to see the grass is greener over there. What are they doing over there? The grass is greener over there. What is it? And some people, He says, when they be ready to respond when they ask you for the hope that's in you. Be ready to give the answer. Hallelujah. Well, that's all I got for tonight.
It was good.
Wonderful.